Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the chalice which the Father has given me?"
So the band of soldiers and the captain and the officers of the Jews seized Jesus and bound him. First, they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had given counsel to the Jews that it was expedient that one should die for the people. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. As this disciple was known to the high priest, he entered the court of the high priest along with Jesus, while Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the men who kept the door and brought Peter in. The men who kept the door said to Peter,
"Are not you also one of these false disciples?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the servants and officers had made the charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all Jews come together. I have said nothing secretly. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying,
"Is that how you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, bear witness to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They said to him,
"Are not you also one of his disciples?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the servants of the high priest, a kinsman of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
"Did I not see you in the garden with him?"
Peter again denied it, and at once the dog crowed. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was early. They themselves did not enter the praetorium, so that they might not be defiled, that they might eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
"What accusation do you bring against this man?"
They answered him,
"If this man were not an evildoer, we would not have handed him over."
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourself and judge him by your own law."
The Jews said to him,
"It is not lawful for us to put any man to death."
This was to fulfill the word which Jesus had spoken, to show by what death he was to die. Pilate entered the praetorium again and called Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingship is not of this world. If my kingship were of this world, my servant would fight, that I might not be handed over to the Jews. But my kingship is not from the world."
Pilate said to him,
"So you are a king?"
Jesus answered,
"You say that I am a king. But he is that was born. And for this, I have come into the world to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice.
Pilate says to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them,
to die, because he has made himself the Son of God.
When Pilate heard these words, he was even more afraid. He entered the praetorium again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave no answer. Pilate therefore said to him,
"You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you?
Jesus answered him,
"You have no power over me unless he has been given you from the womb. Therefore, he will deliver me to you as the greater sin."
Upon this, Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Anyone who makes himself a king sets himself against Caesar."
When Pilate heard his words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at the place called the pavement, and he gave that battle. Now it was the day of the preparation of the Passover, which was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews,
"Here is your king."
They cried out,
"Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and he went out, bearing his own cross to the place called the place of the skull, which is called in him Golgotha. Then they crucified him, and with him two others, one on the other side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote the title and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. The chief priests of the Jews then said to the Pilate,
"Do not write, King of the Jews. Yes, this man said, 'I am King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments made four parts, one for each soldier, also his tunic, and the tunic of the same, woven from top to bottom. So they said to one another,
let us not hear it, but cast lots, for it is him whose it shall be.
This was to fulfill the scripture. They parted my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. So the soldiers did this. They standing at the cross of Jesus where his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother,
woman, behold your son.
Then he said to the disciple,
behold your mother.
And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was not finished, said to fulfill the scripture,
I blessed
a bowl full of vinegar stood there. So they put the sponge full of the vinegar for this and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the vinegar, he said,
it is finished.
And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. All the
Thank you.
My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this Friday is called Good. Good Friday because on such a day as this, Christ demonstrated his unconditional love by dying to save us. From the cross, he proclaimed his message of love and forgiveness. St. Paul tells us in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, that God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The cross becomes a symbol of redemption, and as the prophet Isaiah in the first reading reminds us, he was pierced through for our faults, crushed for our sins. On him lies the punishment that brings us peace, and through his wounds we are healed. The liturgy today expresses our sense of emptiness and sorrow. At the beginning of the service, the Archbishop and the priests prostrated themselves before the altar for some time. The altar is stripped without altar clothes or decorations, and the tabernacle is empty. As we empty ourselves, therefore, of all sin and iniquity, we ask Jesus to fill us with life and grace once again. During the stations of the cross, in the morning hours that we had, our youths creatively and very commendably dramatized the passion narrative. They did well to portray the different characters and immerse us into the scenery of what happened over 2,000 years ago. I remember on one occasion as this, a few years ago, as the character who played the role of Jesus was beaten and led to crucifixion, the soldiers whipped him from every side. Those among them who had real whips were careful only to target the wood of the cross. Somehow, one of the real whips went past the wood to actually flog the Jesus character. The way he cried this time was different. No longer acting, he himself shouted, "Jesus!" And it sprang out of true deep pain. I was standing very close to him, and I could hear in his cries, as if he was seeming to say to the soldiers, "Don't flog me again with that whip. I am not Jesus Christ." No one in human history could bear the depth of pain and suffering that Christ bore for the whole world. That great sacrifice and blood shed on the cross is the Mass itself, and we're only having the Good Friday service. So the cross lies at the heart of our reflection today. We have followed Jesus and accompanied him through the stations of the cross. In that journey, we cannot merely be spectators watching from afar. We are involved in some way. It is impossible before the cross to remain neutral. We have to take a stand. Pilate tried to be neutral when he washed his hands off the case of Jesus in favor of his political career among the Jews. The question is, on whose side are we? On the side of the crowds? Or the hatred of the Pharisees and scribes, or the weeping women of Jerusalem, or the deserting disciples? Going through the passion narrative, we come across stations of all the faces of suffering humanity. First, Christ was not betrayed by an enemy, but from one among his disciples. How much do we suffer betrayals from those we trust, from those within our households and communities? They betray our confidence, our hopes, our values, and even our goals. The crowds demanded to release Barabbas, a hardened criminal, rather than Jesus. Unfortunately, even in our times, people are still determined to choose criminality over integrity, to suppress the voice of truth and to enthrone falsehood. People are still determined to make the wrong social, economic, and political choices over empty material promises. The same crowds that hailed, "Hosanna to the Son of David" on Palm Sunday, now shouted, "Crucify him, crucify him." How easy it is for praise singers to roll out drums of judgment when the attractions and selfish benefits are no longer there. In the ruthlessness and cruelty of the soldiers who flogged and dragged Jesus, mocked him and crowned him with thorns and led him to be crucified, we remember the sufferings of all those in our country, especially who are victims of violent conflict, kidnapping, banditry. These people suffer under the watch of the government and security agents who are sworn to protect them. Jesus himself was crucified at the age of 33. He shed his blood for humanity as a youth, not as an old man. How many of our young people out there have their dreams squashed, their hopes dashed, their future mortgaged for some selfish political interest? They are crucified socially, educationally, economically, and even otherwise. For some who have lost their lives in the process, their hopes and aspirations lay buried with them in their graves. We also saw in Mary, the mother of our Lord, a courageous and a faithful woman whose heart was pierced with sorrow, yet able to endure seeing her only son wrongfully accused, thoroughly beaten, and crucified. How many of us could stand that? Today, millions of Nigerians, languishing in social and economic deprivations, still seem to keep their cool, suffering and smiling, ready to carry on believing, as is often said, one day it will be better. However, in the same passion narrative, full of sorrow and pain, we come across some stations of consolation and hope. When Peter cut off the ear of the high priest's servant, we saw Jesus healing the wounded servant, Malchus, performing what our Archbishop often refers to as the first plastic surgery in the world. The love of Christ goes beyond boundaries. His mission is to heal and to restore. We saw Simon of Cyrene, a foreigner and an African, who probably was a victim of foot traffic or passing by at the opportune time, forced to carry the cross of Jesus. He represents all of us, drawn from everywhere to be rather honored to partake in the cross of Christ and also to share in his glory. We see Veronica wipe the face of Jesus. In our sorrows and grief, there are Veronicas along life's journey to console, to encourage, and to assure us that we are not alone in our trials and temptations. Hanging on the cross, Jesus bequeathed his mother to us as a parting gift. In John chapter 19, verse 27, he said, "Behold your mother." He handed to us as next of kin the Queen of heaven and earth, who intercedes for us, for our needs and those of our church. On the cross, Jesus promised the dying thief. He said to him, "Today you will be with me in paradise." That promise is also ours. At the cross, we are forgiven, we are healed, and we are restored in grace. To our departed ones who sleep in the peace of Christ, the promise is also theirs, that they will find light, happiness, and peace. When Jesus said, "It is finished," on the cross, he had given up everything. What was accomplished was our salvation. Who was finished was the devil. What was finished was the rule of sin over our lives. Sin was finished, Satan was finished, and death was finished. The many stations of suffering also have stations of consolation. Our lives are something like that, punctuated by sufferings, yet full of great hope only in Jesus. What we have lost, what we lost when our first parents chose the temptations of darkness to the blessedness of light, Christ came to restore by his sacrifice on the cross. We celebrate, therefore, the triumph of the cross, a symbol of shame that Christ transformed to become the signpost of redemption and center of worship. The sacrifice of Jesus calls us to die to the self. That means freely, willingly, and courageously accepting our crosses rather than refusing them or avoiding them. Carrying our crosses also means resisting worldly ways and its eroding values, and asking God to help us to do what He wants us to do, His will rather than ours. St. Paul says in Galatians 5:24, all who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. The second reading reminds us that we have Jesus, the great high priest, who himself knows our human weaknesses and challenges. And he assures us that in faithfully doing his will, our sacrifices will never be in vain. We are urged to approach his throne of grace, confident of his mercy and help. At the foot of the cross is a place of exchange, where hatred is exchanged for love, where sickness is exchanged for healing, where frustrations are exchanged for favor, and where death is exchanged for life. The self-emptying of Christ is also a challenge for contemporary leadership, where the shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He offers himself up to serve and not to be served. In our country, bad governance and corruption have seen Jesus crucified again and again. He is crucified in the millions of Nigerians on the streets who are neglected in their poverty. He is crucified in all those who are marginalized and oppressed. He is crucified in our unemployed youths, the weak and vulnerable. He is crucified in the elderly and retirees who are denied their pensions, their rights and benefits of serving our dear country. We continue to pray for our recently elected leaders, that they may uphold the principles of equity, justice and fairness as they stay true to their campaign promises. We pray that they may prove uniting factors among our people divided along different lines, that by their sacrifices, our nation Nigeria may truly become more and more a home for every one of us. There is something to emulate from the personalities of Joseph of Arimathea, who asked Pilate for permission to bury the body of Jesus, and also Nicodemus, who offered a mixture of myrrh and aloes. They were not ashamed to identify with Jesus after his crucifixion and death. We too are invited to emulate these virtuous men in identifying with Jesus in the sufferings of the poor and needy, the sick, the aged, the rejected, and the dejected. During the veneration of the cross, when we touch the crucifix or adore the Lord, let us ask Jesus in turn to touch our hearts, to heal our souls, and to renew his grace within us. May it inspire us to grant forgiveness, to seek peaceful and harmonious living, and to mend broken relationships. As we contemplate the cross of Christ, we join our prayers with Mary, who bore all these things in her heart and treasured them to the very end. We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you, because by Holy Cross you redeem the world.
May we all stand for the solemn intercessions. Holy Church, let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and to grant that leading our lives in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty.
Let us kneel.
Of heart, they may find their way to God Himself.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people, to seek you always, by desiring you and by finding you, come to rest. Grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love, the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
For those in public office, let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will for the true peace and freedom of all.
Let us kneel.
Almighty, ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern the authority of us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may, through your gift, be made secure through Christ.
For those in tribulation, let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loose fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand. Through Christ our Lord.
For the afflicted in time of pandemics, let us pray also for all those who suffer the consequences of pandemics around the world, that God the Father may grant health also to the sick, strength to those who care for them, comfort to families, and salvation to all the victims who have died.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Almighty, ever-living God, only support of our human weakness, look with compassion upon the sorrowful condition of your children who suffer because of many pandemics. Relieve the pain of the sick. Give strength to those who care for them. Welcome them into your peace. Those who have died and throughout this time of tribulation, grant that we may all find comfort in your merciful love, through Christ our Lord.
Put in our seats and continue with the veneration of the cross.
Behold the wound of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Let us kneel. Let us stand.
Behold the wound of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world.
Catholic hymn 191. Hymn 191.
Thank you. Thank you. stand.
Let us now together recite the prayer of love, the prayer of unity, the prayer of peace that Jesus taught us to pray. The body of Christ keep us safe for eternal life. Thank you.
Please, it is now time for offering. Thank you.
We thank God for this privilege to journey with Him to be part of this passion for this year. It is our prayer that the offerings and the sacrifices we've made may continue to find acceptance before God through Christ our Lord. We continue the Paschal Triduum tomorrow. It will begin with, we'll have confessions in the morning. It will end at 8 a.m. However, we're going to meet again at 8 p.m. tomorrow for the Easter Vigil. Please keep in mind that while coming for the Easter Vigil, try and come with a stick of candle. A stick of candle. That is meant to help us usher in the light of Christ that dispels all darkness. Another thing worthy of note is the cross that has been venerated. If we are going to be crossing the middle aisle, the front of the sanctuary here, please do well to genuflect, not bow. Genuflect, not bow. Let's keep this in mind. As Jesus, who has died for us, laid in the sepulchre, let us give Him the worship that is due to Him. So, by the special grace of God, we hope to meet again tomorrow to continue to be a part of the Paschal mystery. May the Lord bless us now and forever.
tell you, time spent with the Lord is not time wasted. So I encourage you to keep it up. And may the Lord, who sees your heart and he knows your needs, grant all to you according to his will. Now stand and let us receive the final prayer. Let's say the final prayer, and then there's no blessing. There is no concluding of the Mass. Nobody will tell you to go in peace. Once we finish the final sentence of the prayer and you say Amen, that is it. We, the priests, will file out, and you will just go out quietly. Choir, thank you for singing, but don't sing. Don't sing again. Because we are still in a state of mourning because of what has happened today. Just go home, be at peace with yourself, reflect on what has happened to Jesus and its impact on all of us. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you through Christ our Lord. Bow down your heads for blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith in